In this video, we are going to see the impact of boosting the CPU power limits on performance as well as thermals. So without any further ado, let's roll. Featuring in this video is the ASUS ROG Strix SCAR 3, which is powered by the 9th gen Intel Core i7-9750H CPU and the ultra portable HP ProBook 440G5, which comes with the 8th gen Intel Core i7-8550U processor. So let's just dig in, starting with the SCAR. With the CPU limited to the stock 45W TDP, the SCAR 3 is only able to manage a score of around 2473 points in Cinebench R20. Looking closely at the frequencies, we see that the i7-9750H in the SCAR averaged around 3.3 GHz throughout the duration of the test. However, the i7-9750H is capable of doing 4 GHz across all the 6 cores. And the CPU temps are nothing to worry about because we are sitting at just 63 degrees, which is pretty cool. And it simply means that we have a lot of thermal headroom to play with. So let's just unlock the power limits on the CPU and see the real potential of this processor unfold. Now that we have let the horses run free, the CPU is finally able to sustain full 4 GHz across all the 6 cores and stabilizes at 80 degrees on the CPU, despite pulling 75 watts, which is much higher than stock. All of this translates into a score of 3145 points, which is a remarkable improvement in performance while still maintaining good thermals. As expected from a gaming laptop, the ROG Strix performed admirably here. So the entire exercise boils down to how good a cooling solution you have inside of your laptop, since the laptop needs to be ready to handle the increased heat due to the extra wattage being pulled by the CPU. So what happens when we repeat the same experiment on a laptop which is not as thermally capable as the Strix? Let's just smash Cinebench R20 on our ultra portable 14-inch HP ProBook. It's gonna be interesting. We repeat the same steps for the ProBook. Testing out the default 15W configuration results in an average of 2.6 GHz with CPU stabilizing at around 77 degrees. And this gets us a score of 1207 points. So it's time to break the shackles and boost the power limits all the way up to 45 watts. The CPU attempts to boost past 30 watts, but it straight away hits the thermal ceiling and throttles back down to just 20 watts, stabilizing at 96 degrees and 2.9 GHz on the CPU. This fetches us about 100 points more compared to stock, which is a no-brainer, especially when we take those high temperatures into account. Obviously, this is no surprise, as ultrabooks are well known for being thermally constrained, a compromise they have to make for the sake of better portability. So in case you happen to own one of these, there's a popular saying, don't try this at home. As an Easter egg, let's just see how the ASUS Strix responds to scenarios wherein the GPU is also active, such as when gaming, for instance. Boosting the power limits while cruising in NFS Payback seems to be an easy proposition going by the temps, right? Well, not exactly. Let me show you why. It's time we skip the warm-up. So fast forwarding 10 minutes into the gameplay and the CPU is already averaging at 90 plus degrees. Earlier in Cinebench, SCAR had no problem with power limits boosted, as it was running pretty cool. So what happened there? I'll explain. Most gaming laptops share the same heatsink between the CPU and the GPU. So when you are doing something like Cinebench, you are constantly hitting the CPU without even touching the GPU, which means that the CPU now has the entire heatsink to itself, thereby boosting higher without getting too hot. But here while gaming, you don't have that luxury anymore, as the GPU is also now active and the cooler has to dissipate 90 watts of GPU power. So all we did is, we just waited it out for about 10 minutes or so for maximum heat soak to happen, and we started seeing high temperatures on the CPU. In fairness to ASUS though, it's still not running super toasty, as It gets to about 93 or 94 C at the very most, and it still does not throttle. It just does well enough to stay far away from thermal throttling, and that's pretty good. Also, at 45 watts, the CPU has no problem whatsoever as it stabilizes at 82 degrees, which is a lot more acceptable compared to what we were seeing earlier. So the task at hand is to maximize performance while ensuring that the thermals stay in check. And the sweet spot lies between 50 to 55 watts. So talking about the GPU temps with the CPU pegged at 45 watts, the GPU has no problem as it stabilizes at 69 degrees. Boosting the CPU to 60 watts while gaming leads to higher GPU temperatures at 76 degrees as the shared heat pipe tries to work in a smarter way. So basically, instead of overburdening the CPU alone with the additional heat, it knows that the GPU has good amount of thermal headroom, and therefore it passes some of that burden over to the GPU, basically acting as a load balancer and thereby minimizing thermal throttling. So let's wrap up this video here. Hope you guys enjoyed this video and had a good learning experience, as we covered a lot about stuff like power limits in depth, and we also studied how thermal management varies as we move between a gaming laptop and an ultrabook. Don't forget to like, share and subscribe, as this motivates me to bring out much more educational content for you guys. So this is Lakshya signing off. See you guys next time. Enjoy the game.
Rolling through the west side.